It is because of her that the ASSC is the vibrant and exciting institution it is today. She stepped up to the plate and took over the association, running the various committees and computer services behind the scenes, helping with the funding, coaxing everybody to do their thing, review submissions, for example, and find the next meeting site. In the tradition and spirit of Patrick Wilkin, who helped get ASSC off the ground in 1997 at its first meeting in Pomona, California, and who was executive director until 2009, Olivia was the power behind the throne that put together the 2010 meeting in Toronto, the 2011 in Kyoto, the 2012 in Sussex, the 2013 in San Diego, and now this one in Brisbane. Having myself done this, I know how much work it is and how little overt acknowledgement one gets from one's peers for such organizational work. So I thank you, Olivia, for all of the enthusiasm and energy that you brought to this task. And in my own voice, let me just add my appreciation of your management style, Olivia. As someone who has worked on various committees during Olivia's time as executive director, what has most impressed me is her ability to keep track, to check in, to nudge and prod without being overbearing. A quick message from her will ask how a project is proceeding or remind of an upcoming deadline. She's also restructured the website, which now manages membership donations as well as conference registration and submissions. The system has been in place so long that it may be difficult to remember that conference organizers previously needed to set up a website of their own every year. An enormous investment in time and energy that now does not need to be reduplicated. For Olivia, the simple and efficient things can be the better. So in honor of that commitment to efficiency, I'll just close by saying thank you, Olivia. You've been a terrific executive director, and you should be very proud of your contribution to making ASSC a world-class organization. Just a little something for you. And Olivia will now introduce Jack Pettigrew. So let's.
Thank you, Paula. No, that was definitely overstated, my contribution, particularly to all the past conferences. I've sort of been the person that just answers the question about what happened at the conference before. It'll be fantastic to see, it'll be nice to not have a million extra emails, but it'll be fantastic to watch ASSC grow over the next few years. But now to switch to the main event today, it's with great pleasure to introduce Jack Pettigrew. So I had the privilege to have Jack as my honours and PhD supervisor here at the University of Queensland over a decade ago or so that I was here. And in terms of introducing Jack and providing an overview of his vast contribution to research, I think the most amazing thing is the diversity of his research, his interest in the diversity of the associated contributions to this work. I think it's fair to say that Jack is universally regarded as not only having a prodigious scientific mind, but also being one of the most interesting people you'll ever meet. He originally studied medicine in Sydney and went from there directly to postdoctoral positions at Berkeley and Caltech before returning to a range of different positions in Australia. In the earliest years, he was most famous for conducting a number of pioneering experiments identifying the mechanisms responsible for binocular vision and depth perception. And I saw one of the publications arising from this research has been cited over 1,000 times. And together, his research looking at early visual processing resulted in countless high-impact papers, including no less than 5 Nature and 7 Science papers from this body of work. He was also inducted as a Fellow of the Royal Society for this research. I think Jack would probably consider himself a visual neuroscientist with a particular focus on comparative neuroanatomy. He's done extremely pioneering research in a range of species from owls to echidnas to platypus. And I often remember back, people often ask what it was like to work with Jack. And one of my favourite stories was when he dished out one of the best retorts to a criticism I've ever heard at a conference. I can't remember exact conference, but it was a sort of visual neuroscience conference, and there's a lot of distinguished people, and someone, it was a very senior academic, asked what seemed like a fairly sensible question at the time about some of the research being presented. And Jack's response was, if you knew anything about the electroperception of a platypus, you'd realise that was a ridiculous question. And it's fair to say that there's probably nobody on the planet that knows more about electroperception of the platypus than Jack. So it was quite interesting to see the dynamic as this person sort of realised, okay, well, wouldn't want to get into that sort of dangerous territory. But actually, as a side note, so I spoke to Jack earlier, well, for anyone coming to the dinner, it's going to be a fantastic venue in the middle of this sort of nature reserve. And there's a lot of amazing animals around, and so certainly you should... I don't know anyone that knows more about different animal, sort of Australian native animal species than Jack, so certainly ask him any questions if you have them. And just to sort of continue on, so in addition to his work on the platypus, Jack did a lot of work looking at bats, and he also developed the flying primate hypothesis, which in my extremely simplistic description is basically the idea that all bats are bats except for some bats that are actually primates that grew wings. It's obviously more complex than that, but that work itself also resulted in more Nature and Science papers, along with an array of many other great publications. More recently, he turned his attention to human perception, focusing a great deal of effort looking at the mechanisms driving perceptual rivalry switching, with a focus on individual differences in switch rate and looking at different clinical populations. This work continues today with a number of people, including Steve Miller, who I know was here somewhere, is still around, hopefully. And now he's officially retired, Jack, but he's as active in research as ever and has turned his attention to rock art and the many lessons that can be learnt from these amazing paintings. So this will be the topic of his talk today, and I'm extremely excited to hear what he has to say.
Thanks, Olivia. Before I sing my song, I should just explain if I slur my speech or give a Castilian lisp, that's because I've got no front teeth. I had an accident in Africa, and I've been on the road ever since, and I haven't had a chance to see a dentist yet. Right now, the story I'm going to tell is about a kind of rock art called Bradshaw rock art. Now, there are attempts to give this an Aboriginal name, which I've resisted and disapproved. I published on this topic because there is actually little evidence that it's connected to the Aboriginal culture. In fact, all the evidence shows that this kind of art is from a culture that died out 10,000 years ago. Now, we'll argue about the timing, but if you're studying rock art that's extinct for 10,000 years, there's a big problem. There you have a circularity. We know that interpreting symbols in art is difficult unless you know all about the cultural context. And I have a slide of a Turkish guy in a skirt, but this cartoon shows it even better. So you have a terrible circularity here because you only got the rock art and you're trying to find out what the symbols mean, but to know what the symbols mean, you've got to know the cultural context. So how do you break that circularity? I have a paper on that. And one way you can break it is to try and find another culture where the witnesses are still alive who can tell you about this culture. And that's what I'm going to do in this talk. Now, it's a very long bow I'm drawing to the sand lineage in Africa. They've been around for between 100 and 200,000 years. They're the oldest lineage of modern humans by far on the planet. There's still a few around and you can study them, and in my talk I'm going to show you the link to that culture. Now, the title comes from a film by Ingmar Bergman, but when I was doing any cinema buffs in the audience, you remember Ingmar Bergman? Right, so when I was doing research for this talk, I discovered that Ingmar Bergman got the... Whoops. Where's this story? That... Hang on. Sorry, what's happening here? Okay, so... So Bergman actually got it from the Bible. There's a beautiful passage in Corinthians 13 by the Apostle Paul. And this is the one, you know, that beautiful passage, love is this, love is not that. It's all about love. So Apostle Paul points out that he thinks the reason we can't see very clearly, we're seeing through a glass darkly, is that we're mortal. And the only way to really see things as they really are is to die and go to heaven. The sand word for die and the sand word to go into a trance are the same. Now this lady, we call her the floating angel, this is an example of the Bradshaw art. I don't think she's flying or floating. I think this is a, what we call a trance visualization. These are images that have been created after someone's experience in a trance. Now I'll enlarge on that hypothesis, but at the end of the talk I'm going to come back to this idea that a trance may be helpful. You know, my own bias has been that it's probably not healthy. I'm not trying to be a Timothy Leary, but I'm going to make the case that you can get a lot of insights from trance. Right, so this is the sort of outline of the talk. The problem with Bradshaw art is nobody really knows for sure anything about it. We don't know who painted them. We don't know when it was painted. We don't know why they're in such a restricted part of Australia. They're in a very tiny part of the North Kimberley. We don't know what most of the icons mean. We don't know why the most sophisticated art is the earliest. This is a case where the culture seems to go downhill. The very earliest art is the most sophisticated and most beautiful. I'm going to present to you a case that they're very old. Well, if they're very old, why do they look so bright? Now, there's an Australian rock art expert who reckons they're less than 10,000 years old because they look so bright. And I'll show you why he's wrong. But there are political questions. Why aren't they so well known? Now, I didn't learn about this kind of rock art until 6 years ago when I retired. So there's an interesting question there. So, well, this thing's not working. I'll have to, okay. So most of the art is fairly small. So this is a famous piece of art called Royal Family. These people are holding bags. They're obviously going somewhere. And this is typical Bradshaw art. They all have conical headdresses. The lines are very fine. And their legs disappear into very thin, we call it hind limb attenuation. Perhaps they're imagining they're a tree and they're the roots or something. What's it? Well, this gadget doesn't work, I'm afraid. Maybe I have to come closer to the machine. So this is one of the oldest styles. And the strange thing is about this art that no one's found any artifacts associated with the art. There's maybe 100,000 sites in the Kimberley, but no one's found any skeletons or any evidence that they lived there. So it's almost certain that they visited the Kimberley, where there are nice big tall rocks that may have attracted them, from the floodplain. Okay, now the floodplain in the Pleistocene, when I think this culture lived, is 4 to 5 times greater than the total area of the Kimberley. We know it had lots of fresh water and lakes, and I'm pretty sure that's where they lived. And I'll show some more evidence later on from the distribution of baobab trees that supports that idea. Now, I'm going to just show you a few examples of this art. Now, sometimes it's faded. You can see here that there's been some faded. Sometimes it's pecking. Some cultures don't like it, and they peck it away. So I've put some outlines around it just to help you see what the art looks like. And this is an example, it's called a sash Bradshaw, because of this sash. And you can see there are 12 different accoutrements on this art, very complicated. At this stage in their evolution, they were very happy, lots of dancing. We don't know what all these accoutrements mean. This one here, Walsh called a chili armpit accoutrement, but doesn't get you any closer to know what it means. So here's one of my favorites. These are two people dancing. So here's the body, here's the conical headdress on this one. Here's their left arm going up with a boomerang. And here's the other person. Here's the conical headdress decorated. Left arm down, right arm up. So very beautiful scene, I think, and the nice straight edge on the skirt makes you wonder whether they even had weaving. It doesn't look like an animal skin. Now, in the Kimberley, this art is sometimes found alongside of Wangina art. So this white ochre overlay has a style, we call it Wangina, and we know this is Aboriginal. So the Wangina art came in from the southeast, the Bradshaw art came in from the northwest, and you never see Wangina art underneath the Bradshaw art. In other words, it's always more recent, and because it's ochre, you can date it fairly satisfactorily 3,000 to 4,000 years. Now, this guy, Graham Walsh, is the reason I'm standing here telling you about this stuff. He's one of these savants. He got a few honorary degrees towards the end of his life, but he didn't go to university. But he collected 1.2 million images of these things. He went up there for 40 years. He traveled up to the Kimberley. He knew more about it than anybody. Unfortunately, he's gone now, but his funeral was a change in my life. I heard his six co-workers describe him and the work he did, and I was blown away. I was sort of sucked in. So now, I'm just going to say something that's a bit political, but I think it's worth pointing out that this guy was reviled in his time, and six anthropologists from Australia crucified him for suggesting that perhaps there were other waves of human migration to Australia. Now, we know now that Walsh was correct, and I can't go into all the evidence, but I'm going to show you. This is a map of the genetics of Denisovans. Now, Denisova Cave had a little finger, it was cold, and the DNA was perfectly preserved, and so Svante Paabo was able to get the whole genome of this 9-year-old lady. We know from the genetics she was 9-year-old, had dark hair and dark hair, but that's all we know about her, really, except that we've got her whole genome. When you go around the world and look for this DNA signature, you find that in Melanesia and all of Southeast Asia, 4% of the genome is characteristic of Denisovans. In other words, the Southeast Asia got a visit from these people. There are no Denisovan DNA here, and I think this is interesting because this corresponds to the outline of the Tobar ash. And I'll just show this. So, when you're working on an extinct culture and you've got this problem of circularity, another way to nail things down a bit is to find a catastrophe that's precisely known in time. Now, the Toba volcano, the Toba volcano blew up in Sumatra. You can go and have your honeymoon on Lake Toba, beautiful lake, and we know exactly how big the lake is, so we know how big the volcanic eruption was. It's the biggest eruption in the last 2 million years. Many cubic kilometres of ejecta went up, and so we know from mapping the ground that this is what the ash was like. So in India, for example, there was 3 metres of ash, and by looking at stone tools above and below the ash, we know it took human culture there, 20,000 years to recover from this catastrophe of the ash. Okay, so there was local ash, and in Africa, the world became very cold, and so I think the survivors would have had to been here, south of the ash, but north of the freezing cold, so in eastern Tanzania. So, so it's interesting the distribution of the ash here corresponds to that boundary between where the Denisovan DNA is found. Now, we've also got the same kind of evidence that the people of continental India also visited Australia about 40,000 years ago. So we've now got two very clear examples where there's 100 million base pairs that you can't deny showing Denisovans were here. Not quite so good for for continental Indians. And I think the same is true for the Bradshaw culture, but it'll be more indirect. Right, so we know how much sulfate cloud there was, and this is agreed around the world. All experts agree that there was a severe darkness. There's 35 log units. This is like being on a moonless, starless, overcast night underneath the canopy, underneath your blanket, right? I mean, really dark. And if you're a hunter-gatherer, and this is 74,000 years ago, even herding wasn't invented then, so you had hunter-gatherers, they would be in a difficult pickle. There'd be no photosynthesis, no green feed for the animals. And even if there were animals, you wouldn't be able to see them. So the geneticists have calculated, on the basis of the fact that modern humans have a total variance of 2%, and the Africans who stayed behind have a variance of 20%, they've calculated that no more than 10,000, and perhaps as little as 1,000 humans, survived this catastrophe. Okay, so this is another event which we can bear in mind when we try to work out what happened to this culture. Now, in this field, very few people write papers. I've never seen so much backbiting as I got a bit of it when I was doing my flying primate story, and when you're doing phylogeny and you're looking at what happened in the past, there's lots of opinion, not so many facts. So in this field, people write books instead of writing papers, so they don't have to deal with the referees who are going to rip them to shreds. Now, the one exception to this is my friend Lee Scott Virtue. She's very generous. She tells me where all her great sites are so I can fly there in the chopper instead of holding my my body over the rough ground. And she's seen many thousands of paintings. I'm just going to show you some of her contributions. They're not well known, as I said, because in this field there's a lot of backbiting. It's very hard to get your papers out. So she has produced a timeline. Now, I'm going to show this a few times in the talk, but the point is, so we're going to go from ancient to modern. Now, this clothes peg figure, it's missing. Okay, there should be a spear here. The first time that you see any weapons is here. All these other examples have happy, dancing, great times. Here corresponds to when the floodplain was inundated. It's now covered with 150 metres of water, so finding out more about the culture will require some fancy underwater archaeology. Haven't got the money to do that yet, but... here are the times. Okay, now, dating this art is extremely difficult. Nobody's got it right yet, I think, and I'll explain some of the difficulties. But we know that this sequence is correct because of superposition. We know, for example, that the classic is never seen on top of the others. This one might be on top of the classic, but not on top of these, and so on. So by studying thousands of paintings and looking at where they're overlapping, you can come up with this timeline. Now, these are names that are accepted in the field. Some people have got sort of alternatives. And you can see, if I'm right about my inferences, that this culture is 70,000 years old, right after Toba. So in anthropology now, a lot of people tend to divide time into pre-Toba and post-Toba. So the Denisovan, the one whose little finger they found in the cave in Siberia, that's pre-Toba. They left Africa 200 or 400,000 years ago. Neanderthals also left Africa way before Toba, like 300,000 years ago. So this culture is post-Toba. The question is, how do we work out what it means and how old it really is? Now, this is an example of the classic. There's only about a dozen of these available. You can imagine if it's the earliest example of the culture, there's not going to be millions of them. So, and it shows some of the features of Bradshaw. So I've blacked it in to make it easy to see. But see these lines here on These are called tassels on the waist. These lines are less than 100 microns across. Now, I challenge you in one brush stroke to draw a line that's 100 microns wide and 10 centimetres long. Even a Renaissance master would have trouble doing that on canvas, but this is rough rock. If you fall over on it, it'll rip your skin off. It's extremely abrasive, very difficult. So I'm just pointing out these people, it must have been trained as artists. They must have reached a very high level to achieve this. You know, we can't even come close. Now, another thing that Lee discovered, now have a look, this is what the art looks like without my blacking it in to help you. Now, here there's a couple holding hands. All of these classics hold hands. You can see it's been pecked. Someone didn't like the fact that they were holding hands, but so this is called pecking. But look at the head. Here's the headdress coming off the back of the head. Here's the headdress coming off the back of the head. We think this is a female and this is a male, but notice that they're looking into the rock. Now, when we look at a photo, we assume that people are looking out at us, but this culture seems to do their painting with the people facing in. Now, not everybody can see this. It's two-dimensional, and if you're interested in bistable figurine, then, you know, sometimes it's hard to see it. And for some reason, males have more trouble agreeing with this than the females. But this has implications because it means that what people have been calling a paunch is actually a bottom. So I'll go back and show. So she's got, so this is the female, she's got a nice bottom. And it means that the statement that all Bradshaw figures are male is up the creek, because if they're facing away from you, how do you know? There's no secondary sexual characteristics to tell. Okay, so it has lots of implications for interpreting the art, and it's a good example of how, you know, a recent finding, this is only a couple of years old, changes our perception. Okay, now I'm going to talk about a finding that I made. I'm not popular because of this, but I've been looking at DNA sequence from a biofilm. It turns out this art, the reason it looks so bright, the reason that it can be submerged in a gritty, abrasive river for every wet season, then come out even better when the water level comes down, is because it's alive. So here's an example of the art, and if we take a digital microscope and have a look at this edge, what we see is a mixture of black and red colonies. I'll show this in more detail in a second. I'll give you just a few more examples. Now, in contrast, this is what, at the same magnification, a Wangena ochre looks like. It's just full of this stuff. There's no evidence of anything living there. But so here's another example down here. So you can see there's black, which is a fungus, and there's red, which is a cyanobacterium. Cyanobacteria are photosynthetic, very interesting bacteria, but also hellish to study. Okay, so here we've got another example of the biofilm. You can see fungi with fruiting bodies on it. The red is the cyanobacterium, and you notice that it's not smooth. There's a big hole here. The art has been eroded by the action of the cyanobacteria. When you put them in the light with a bit of water, they create so much hydroxyl ion, they can etch quartz. This is quartzite. They can etch it away. So the art is not only coloured by the cyanobacteria, it's been etched. So these microbes know where to go. They stay faithfully within the art because the art has been marked by the action of the cyanobacteria. So this is what one looks like in a microscope. The fungus I've cultured, this fungus, I've sequenced this one. I haven't been able to sequence the cyanobacteria yet for reasons that I'll explain. But the fungus has its closest relative in Antarctica. There's a fungus called Friedmaniomyces that lives in cracks in the rock out of the weather, so to speak. So it's the closest relative to this rock-inhabiting fungus. It's black, it's extremely black. The melanin helps protect it against sunlight and dehydration and so on. The cyanobacteria surround themselves with a capsule of gunk, really horrible sticky gunk that makes it very hard to isolate the DNA because it comes down with the DNA. How did the cyanobacteria get into the ark? Good question. Since it happened 70,000 years ago, I can't be sure, but my hypothesis is the following. In the wet season in the Kimberley, there's water everywhere, but in the dry season, when the water dries up, you have these things called ink streaks. If you take a little piece of this, it's like a skin, if you take a little piece of it, put it in water, and put a bit of light on it, it actually fizzes, and the fizz is oxygen. When you put it in the microscope, it's 100% cyanobacteria. So I think what happened was that the artists used this stuff. It's all over the Kimberley. There's tons of it. I think they used it in their paint, perhaps to make the paint darker or to make it thicker. And then when they put their paint on the wall, they were unconsciously, or perhaps later on intentionally, inoculating the rock wall with the cyanobacteria. That's my hypothesis. So that's the fungus, and so it's black, and it has this. It also has sticky glue. So there's glue from the fungi, and there's glue from the cyanobacteria, and that's what forms the bulk of the biofilm. So you can do a tree. So you find that the DNA from neighbouring art is similar, but art that's well displaced has quite a different kind of DNA. So we know it's not blowing around. We know that it's local. So if you calculate, if you erect a tree, a phylogenetic tree, then you can hopefully get some idea about the age. Now, the trouble with my hypothesis about using the DNA to get the age is it's a new species to science, and even when you've got a number of steps in the tree, we can count the steps in the tree. If you don't know the mutation rate, you can't get the age. And so at the moment, I know what the range of mutation rates is, and that means this art is quite old. It's at least 30,000 years since the paint was put on there, but it might be as much as 70,000. So what we're trying to do at the moment is to get some physical method of dating so we can calibrate the mutation rate of the... Now, Australia's doyen of dating is Bert Roberts. There's a beautiful paper on the ash from the Tobar, where his accuracy is 100 years. It's pretty amazing to have an accuracy of 100 years at 74,000 years. He's worked on megafauna. Now, there are lots of traps for young players here. What Roberts did was to suggest that when you take bones from fossils, you may be misled by little cracks in the bone which collect more recent material, little bits of wood or dirt or so on. So what he did was to take out the teeth of the megafauna, drill into the teeth, and use his methods to age the megafauna. What's remarkable about this paper is he's got three different species, diprotodons and marsupial lions and so on, and he's got different places, and the age is all exactly the same, 46.5 thousand years. Now, he's dated the Bradshaws by looking at wasp nests. When the wasps bring in their mud, there are little bits of quartz crystal in the mud, and if you keep it dark and go back to your lab, you can work out the age of the quartz. So again, he supports this being Pleistocene. It's certainly old, but as I showed, there's a whole range of ages possible with these art, and so he wasn't able to get the earliest members of the sequence. So from his work on the megafauna, we know that there are depictions of someone with a spear fending off a marsupial lion. It's not a fossil lion, it's a live lion, right? So we know that the art must be at least the age of that lion, okay, which is 46,500 years. Now I'm going to talk about this question of trance. Now, I've been criticised for dragging shamanism into my work by a couple of pommies, and I don't take this, you know, to heart too much, but the complaint is that shamanism is a very popular kind of explanation, right? So, too popular. Now, my thesis on transvisualization by these cultures is based on the work of this man, who I saw in Africa just a few weeks ago. He's a bit older than me even, so if you want to actually talk to him, you have to hurry up probably. But anyway, he's written 5 or 6 books in detail about the San. Okay, the San of this ancient 100 to 200,000 year old lineage in Africa. They paint beautifully. They really have beautiful painting, very like the Bradshaw painting, which I'm going to get to. And because he speaks the Click languages, and because until recently a lot of their ceremonies were still going. They're not going now. I didn't get to see a trance dance, unfortunately, but he did. So he is the first person to take a painting that might have 30 people in it, all doing different things, and interpret every one of them in the light of what he knew about that ritual. So the trance dance, you have a circle of women, and then the men have a larger circle, and they chant and stamp. They've got shells on their ankles, give a very nice sound, and it takes 6 to 8 hours. Sometimes the sun's coming up by the time they go into their trance. Now, I went to Africa because I got the impression from reading these books that everybody went into the trance, but it turns out I was wrong about that. There's a few people go into the trance and the rest participate in the whole process and they learn from it, but only a few people actually go into the trance. Now, here's a self-portrait of a shaman who's been in a trance, and it really tells you a lot of things you need to know. First of all, when they enter the trance, their nose bleeds. Epistaxis is a fancy word for nosebleed. He's carrying the stigmata of a shaman, a stick and a fly wisp. But this is the thing I want to get your attention to. His legs have been turned into the hooves of an eland. The eland is the most significant animal for these people. It's the biggest antelope. It's twice as big as a kudu. Huge animal. So if you catch one, you bring a lot of food back to the village. The other thing is an eland doesn't have to be hunted with this very complicated and difficult routine of poison arrow and then track for 3 or 4 days until the animal dies. In the case of eland, you can run them down. You have 3 or 4 men in a relay team, and they're so big and heavy, you can exhaust them by running them down. So, and there's lots of other reasons why elands are really special. Now, so this sort of captures the fact that when they go into this trance, they imagine. Now, the trance, I'll talk about trances that are induced by entheogens like psilocybin. When you're in this state, the boundaries between objects become blurred. So your hand is on the table, it becomes hard to tell where your hand ends and the table begins. And so what these people say is they're visiting a spirit world where they're mixing with the important animals and plants in their life. And so Lewis Williams' interpretation of this very interesting transformation, we call it, this is what they call a therianthrope, part animal, part human, and this is the result of this painter recreating the experience that he had during the trance. Now, just to make things a bit more media savvy, people read The English Patient or seen the movie? Nobody's seen it. So in the movie, there's actually a beautiful scene where Kristen Scott Thomas has a painting of these guys. Now, it's called the Swimmer's Cave because Almasy thought they were swimming. Well, I don't think they're swimming. Now, I can't go to the gallows on this in this case because they're not wearing clothes, I think they're actually having an out-of-body experience. And the reason I think that is this phenomenon of horizontal is very common in these paintings to do with transvisualization. For example, now this next one, okay, right. So this is a Bradshaw, this is my own work. So here's probably a woman. She's got what was beaded hair, the coloured beads have worn out from the ochre. She's got this attenuation of her legs, which is common in Bradshaw. She's got the beautiful headdress coming down. You can see a little man running here. Now, it's very common. Micropsia is a very common side effect of these trances. You imagine giants sometimes. More likely, you see little men running around. And my thesis is that someone who's got all these accoutrements, she's got tassels, she's got a headdress, she's unlikely to be going for a swim. She's much more likely to be having an out-of-body experience. So I treat this as a transvisualization because there are many other sort of concomitant changes in the art. Now here is the original of the figure that I used to start my talk, just to show you what it looks like if you're really there. Now, this was discovered by a German artist who was with us last year on expedition. We spent 10 days camped in this area. All of us walked past this. It was up high, and there was a tree whose shadow cast on this, so it was almost impossible to see. I don't know how Astrid discovered it, but and it also has micropsia. There's a little one like this one, but a little one alongside it. So there's the little one, okay? And this is Astrid. She's an artist. She's had three exhibitions in Germany based on her knowledge of Bradshaw art, and they've all sold out. Very, very beautiful, very beautiful art. So if you count up the number of references to elands in African San art, and Lewis Williams did this, there's about 600 cases. 547 of them were elands. Whoops. Oh, God, this thing. So elands are very important to that culture. Now, we don't have elands in Australia, so what do you think might be the equivalent? What would be an important object for the Bradshaw culture? Well, if they were related to the San, I should have said that my hypothesis is that they may well be San derived. So I'm going to talk about boabs. You know, in Australia we contract everything. Everywhere else in the world they're called baobabs, but in Australia they're called boabs. But anyway, I'll probably flick between the two alternatives. Now, my work on these shows that they were brought to Australia by people, very likely, 70,000 years ago. And that's why I'm putting the boabs with the oldest Bradshaws. Because I find hundreds of references to boabs in these old Bradshaw paintings. Now, let me just say a few words about... Right, so Australia's baobabs are found in a very narrow region of the Kimberley, just along the coast, and they could grow anywhere. Okay, in fact, they've even transported one by truck to Perth, which is growing fine in Perth. So they're very frost sensitive. They explode in the frost, so you won't find them if there's too much frost. But they could grow anywhere along this arc. But they're only found here. How come? And how come the distribution of the Bradshaw art is the same as the distribution of baobabs? Okay, now, the oldest Bradshaws, the ones that I call classic, are found on the northwest coast. So you can imagine that they've arrived here and they're spreading that way. There's not a perfect correspondence, and my detractors say, Jack, you know, I found a Bradshaw and there wasn't any baobabs nearby. Well, you know, you don't expect to have a baobab tree growing in the front of every piece of art There's probably about a million pieces of art in the Kimberley. Now, the Baobab distribution is extending eastward because there's a river here, the Victoria River, and the pods float and they get carried upstream. You don't have baobabs here, as I said, because there's frost. might be a surprise to hear that they get frost in the Kimberley. Well, they do. In the Central Plateau, every 10 years or so, they get a frost, which would wipe out the baobabs. Now, there's one other thing I just want to point out. Using genetics, so I'm using molecular genetics to work out how old the baobabs are, how long they've been in Australia. We noticed a couple of rare cases where we've got a haplotype that's unique to the baobabs, but one's found here, and the same haplotype is found here. Nothing in between. This dispersal clearly wasn't overland. It must have been via the floodplain. So that's another piece of evidence supporting this idea that this culture lived on the floodplain, where there was lots of good food and water going right up to Timor. What's that? Okay, all right. So why would we want to make the baobab special? I can give a whole talk on baobabs. In my iPhone, I've got 49 uses for the baobab. Great food, and so if Schweitzer said 6 bananas a day would keep a grown man going, well, for baobabs, it's 300 grams of seed a day. It's very nutritious. And, well, I can't go through this, but my favourite is that the sand, when they're making poison arrows, occasionally prick themselves, get sick. Well, the antidote for strophanthin poison is found in the bark of the baobab. This is a dogon on a rope made of baobab, so it's very useful. So here are some references to baobabs in the art. It's very common to see a baobab pod. It's never in the hand of the subject, it's always floating in space like that. So here's some examples of baobab pods in Bradshaw art. And you see transformation. We call these dendrianthropes because you've got a baobab pod instead of a hand. And there are another example here. Here's a human figure, and the arm comes down, and then you get leaves on it, and then there's a baobab pod on the end. So by inference from here, I think that it's very likely that the Bradshaw culture revered the baobab because its long storage time, it lasts a year on the tree, may have enabled them to withstand the Toba famine. The famine lasted for years, and I think they may have recognised that was what saved them in Africa. So here's the evidence that baobabs, 72,000 years old. This species here was one that I actually discovered. Pretty good for a neuroscientist to discover a new species of baobab. The problem was that the Australian baobab is diploid. The African one that they thought was the closest relative was tetraploid, but there was an unrecognised diploid. So now there's no problem in imagining that this African origin of the baobabs. And the timing is a bit of a coincidence that it's the same timing as the age of the art and the age of the first migrants from Africa. So I think it's very likely that baobabs were brought to Australia by this culture. Okay, so just to finish off now, there are three remaining remnants of the sand in Africa. They used to go all the way from the Cape to the Sahara. In the last 3,000 years, they've been displaced by the Bantu-speaking people. Bantu-speaking Africans have only been around for 3,000 years. These have been around for at least 100,000 years. So this is boring, but this is 16 links which uniquely connect the Bradshaw culture to the African sand culture. I won't go through it because I'm running out of time, apparently. But so these two cultures have very beautiful depictions of fauna. They're very accurate. I've written three papers recognising extinct fauna from the Bradshaw art. It's so good. They capture it so well. Now, another feature of the sand is peppercorn curls. So here, and it's very rare to find Bradshaw art that where the hair is visible, but occasionally you see it, and Lee found a couple of cases. So it looks like the Bradshaw culture also had peppercorn curls, another link. I've already mentioned the very fine artwork. Now here is a three-point sash which is shared between the Sahara sand and Bradshaw's. The Tuaregs think it might be a connection to the stars. Here's a remarkable similarity between this onion skin post-trance art from the Bradshaw and from the Sandawi, who are one of those branches of the sand that I showed you. Mushroom head, it's interesting. If you ask them what that means, they say, that's what it feels like when you've been on magic mushrooms. And so what you've got here is exactly the same symbol, one in Australia and one in Africa. And so my inference is that the Australian culture, the Bradshaw culture, also use psilocybin. Not difficult to get hold of. And otherwise it's hard to explain. You have to use, say, convergent evolution to explain how it appeared in the two countries. Okay, similarities in these transformations between animals and people. Now here I've got one from Paleolithic art, and I'm just going to finish with Paleolithic art. Now Dean Snow caused a stir this year by measuring the hands of stencils in the Paleolithic caves, 40,000 years old, in Europe. And the first thing that caused trouble was that they were mostly female, but what interested me was there's a dramatic difference between the metrics of the ancient Paleolithic hands and modern hands. So I just went to Africa and studied the sand, because sand's an old lineage. Maybe they'll be old in their hands too. Well, here's an example. So here's a sand woman. You can see her index finger is almost as long as her middle finger. So the ratio of D2 to D4 is going to be very high. And so what we get, I'll just go to the summary. So her hand would be very deep, long tip, her hand would be way out here, and you can see the sand have big difference between males and females, like the Paleolithic ones, and quite different to the small difference in modern hands. So this leads to something that hasn't been suggested before, but namely that the cave art in Europe is actually by the sand. They left Africa and right, so this is Mellar's work. So there are two routes into the cave. Here's the cave art. There are two routes, one northern route and one warm Mediterranean-hugging route. And this route here, the stone tools that are used are so small, you wouldn't believe they could bring down a deer unless there was poison on the end. So I think that this hypothesis that, in fact, the sand got to Europe, and to Australia, by the way, is worth checking up. Each time I check it out, there seems to be strong support for this pretty crazy idea. What's against this idea is that if you look at the genetics of modern Europeans, there's no evidence that LOD, which is the sand haplotype, it's a haplotype only found in the sand, you don't find it in modern Europeans. And so a lot of people say, you're wet, Jack, that can't be right. There's no evidence that the sand... Well, maybe, but maybe they were wiped out in the way that they're being wiped out in Africa at the moment. So absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. They may well have... And the fact that the cave-dwelling art is short-lived in Europe tends to support that. Anyway, that's the hypothesis, that the beautiful art So now, if you show this to someone and say, where did this come from? They'll say, oh, that's African sand rock art. Well, it's not. This is from Altamira. Altamira is in Spain. It's one of the famous Paleolithic caves with art in it. So, okay, well, I was going to finish with an account of trance. It turns out, I have to tell a story here. When Olivia and I were working on psilocybin in Switzerland, where you studied 60 people with this drug, and I was keen to find out what it was like to go on psilocybin, but on the day appointed for me to take my psilocybin, they said, Jack, I'm sorry, you're high risk, you're a manic, and we can't give you the psilocybin. So, very disappointing. But at lunch, around the table, they're all talking about what it was like to be on psilocybin, and I realized I'd been there before. Mania has all the hallmarks of psilocybin trance, really. I can't go into all the details now, but one thing that I couldn't figure out, when the sand people go into their trance, which I was interested in because they do it without drugs, okay, there are Sandawi and Hudson Bay people that use drugs, but the Koh I San that I visited in Namibia do not use drugs, and they have this nosebleed. I thought, well, that doesn't fit, but it turns out there's a clinic in Mexico that treats overdoses of psychoactive drugs like mescaline and psilocybin. And guess what's at the top of their list for a psilocybin overdose? Nosebleed. We have time to show some switches, or what's the story? I don't even know what the time is. I do.
Time, we sort of at time.
Okay. Well, I'm just going to show you, just so you can experience. So in the field, I have a way of measuring the interhemispheric switch test. Now, this is mentioned. In a population like this, the range of the switch, which is pretty stable in individuals, similar in identical twins, the range in this room would be about a factor of 5 or 6. In a big class of 700, 1,000, the range is an order of magnitude. The slowest switch is 10 times slower than the fastest switch. Okay, so I thought that these sand people, if they could go into a trance spontaneously, maybe they're like me, maybe they've all got a slow switch. And so I went into the field, and that's what they're doing here. They're all looking at the screen, which is back here. So I'm going to just show you a couple of these switch tests now so you can see some right. Right, so in this switch, there are two percepts. One of them is what they call a plaid, and most of you have probably seen diamonds moving upwards in a fixed plaid. But if you keep looking at it, it'll change, and then you'll see two gratings sliding over each other. We call that sliding. People seeing that? People seeing the two percepts? If you've never seen it before, the diamonds percept will be first, and it'll hang around for a while, but then you'll see the sliding. Most people got it going. So I'll show another one. Right, so some of you have seen this before. Now, this is interhemispheric switching. So you've got to imagine whether you're looking at her from above. Is she going clockwise or is she going anti-clockwise? Now, this is a good test if you want to locate the fast switches in the audience. So in my case, it takes many minutes to switch. But in a regular audience like this, it'll be switching every few seconds. So who hasn't seen it switch yet? If you want to reveal yourself, right, okay. So you tend to find, if you check a university sample, that the intellectual departments like mathematics and philosophy and probably neuroscience, they tend to have switch on the slow side. So you might have to be patient to see her switch. But she's on my website, so we can't wait all day for everyone to switch. I'll just show a couple more. Right. So you should see a bull. Now, some people tend to see a mixed percept with us. If you're really happy and you're laughing, you'll see both possibilities at the same time. But But most of you will be seeing a ball, and if the ball's rolling towards you, down in the front, that's your left hemisphere in charge. And if you see it rolling away from you, that's your right hemisphere in charge. This one takes me 2 minutes.